When I read a headline that says over 40% of cloud environments are vulnerable to remote code execution, I stop what I'm doing and figure out what the hell that article is about. This time, it's not even clickbait. Wiz's security research team just put out a series of vulnerabilities that lead to full remote code execution in over 40% of Kubernetes clusters. The root cause of this is a default feature in an Ingress controller called Ingress Nginx. It's wildly popular, and until this week when the patch came out, hackers were able to run whatever code they wanted. It could steal every secret across every namespace in your Kubernetes cluster, and that's why it's being called Ingress Nightmare. Who doesn't love a vulnerability with a cute nickname? So what I'm gonna get to in this video is all four of the vulnerabilities that are part of the attack chain that lets these researchers do this remote code execution. It's really important to understand these four vulnerabilities because as this research paper concludes, it mentions that this is just the tip of the iceberg in their research. There's a lot of attack surface here, and as this research shows, they are not abiding by like least privilege principles when it comes to this Kubernetes architecture. So it's important for us to understand these vulnerabilities to try to get out ahead of any of these future ones. So I want to go through the vulns, I want to go through Kubernetes official response from it, and I want to teach you guys how to go protect yourself to upgrade so you're not vulnerable to this attack. And I also want to show you a demonstration of the attack. But before that, I got to pay the bills. So let's hear a word from our sponsor. Quick break to tell you about today's sponsor, Vanta. If you're building or scaling your security program, this next part is definitely for you. At some point, someone you're trying to do business with is going to ask you, hey, are you SOC 2 compliant? Or how about ISO 27001? Or how about HIPAA? And all of a sudden, instead of building a product, you're neck deep in security questionnaires and spreadsheets and policy creation. And I've seen it happen time and time again, where you have very talented engineers all of a sudden filling out spreadsheets about your security program. This is exactly where Vanta comes in. And I could spend this time reading some stuff from their website about how they automate 90% of the work that it takes to get compliant via all of these popular frameworks. But instead, I wanted to tell you about my real experience with Vanta. If you don't know, I do a lot of advisory CISO type work. I've also been on both sides of this are you SOC 2 compliant question. I've built security programs from the ground up for startups, and I've helped run huge parts of security programs for giant financial institutions who have to ask these kinds of questions. A number of startups that I'm advising right now as their CISO are using Vanta to help get them compliant in weeks instead of months. We're talking companies with, prior to me coming on board, no sense of a security program and barely an IT team. Instead of spending all this time not building their product, they fire up Vanta and it gives them exactly what they need to become SOC 2 compliant, which their potential customers and investors are currently asking them to be as soon as possible. That's why I'm super stoked that Vanta decided to sponsor the channel. They've given my audience a discount code that you can get $1,000 off if you go to vanta.com/MattJ. It's time you figured out why over 10,000 companies, including Atlassian or Factory or Flow Health, are using Vanta to manage risk and prove security in real time. Again, this discount code can get you $1,000 off at vanta.com/MattJ. All right, back to the video. All right, thanks so much to our sponsor. Let's get into this attack. So here's the actual research that dropped from Wiz on their blog. As they call out, this was actually rated a 9.8 in the CVSS scale. This is out of 10, this is about as high as it goes. But this subtitle really grabbed my attention. All right, so let's go through these four vulnerabilities. I'll explain a little bit about the basics of what you need to understand to really understand these vulnerabilities, and then we'll get into each one of them. So first of all, what the heck is an Ingress controller? So a little bit of a history lesson here. I used to be the head of security for a startup that was built on top of a very early version of Kubernetes. So early, in fact, that the concept of an Ingress controller didn't exist, or it was in its infancy. So when I got there, the team had built Nginx in a container and was running that in the Kubernetes pod. But because of that, any of the traffic that came to that Nginx reverse proxy, the Kubernetes logs lost all semblance of the source IP address that was sending those requests. It was turning it from HTTP load balancer into a network load balancer. So when I got there, we pulled Nginx out of the container, ran it on a raw VM, and then used that as the entry point into our Kubernetes cluster. We did this in order to actually preserve the Nginx configuration and all of the HTTP request information that comes with that for our logs. As the security guy, I very much cared about that. Then while we were troubleshooting that whole thing, so this is really dating me, this is back in like 2015, Kubernetes team came out with this whole concept of these Ingress controllers, and we started to climb that learning curve. This was a way to control the inbound and outbound traffic into your Kubernetes cluster to make it useful to be on the internet. So Nginx, obviously a wildly popular reverse proxy and load balancing tool, was a good candidate for Kubernetes to just support naturally as one of these Ingress controllers. So this Ingress Nginx controller is actually officially put out by Kubernetes, has over 18,000 stars on GitHub. And as they say, over 40% of Kubernetes clusters have this particular Ingress controller installed. So as they say, its job is to accept incoming traffic and route it to the relevant Kubernetes services, which in turn forwards the traffic to the appropriate pods based on a set of rules. We're going to get into the weeds, but I want to keep this to a degree that people that aren't Kubernetes administrators can actually enjoy this video. So long story short, if you're not a Kube admin, a lot of this is done via configuration files and YAML files and things like that. So one of the core concepts we need to understand to understand this vulnerability is this concept of an admission controller. This is used to validate incoming Ingress objects before they're deployed. But because of that, admission controllers are accessible for unauthenticated users, which is why the security researchers are focusing on this. They are going to accept input from an unauthenticated user. So if there are not security guardrails around this admissions controller, makes a really good target for hackers. So the admission controller is going to process an incoming Ingress object, and then it's going to construct an Nginx proxy configuration from that. So that is the root of this whole attack. And during the actual validation process of like building that Nginx configuration, it's actually going to run the code that it supplies. And it does it with elevated privileges. Again, this is juicy, juicy attack target verbiage here. So when I also first read about this stuff, I saw that it had to be executed from within a Kubernetes pod. So I was thinking, okay, maybe this can't be exploited from the internet. But as I was doing some reading, it sounds like that isn't actually as hard as it sounds. So as they say, gaining initial access to a cluster pod network, not as difficult as you might think. Many applications running on Kubernetes are susceptible to container escape. They've shown previous research for this. And then also that SSRF pairs really, really well with these vulnerabilities, which I can attest to. SSRF is everywhere right now. If you're a bug bounty hunter and you are not focusing on SSRF, you're leaving money on the table. This is rampant and it's really hard to find with automation. So using a server-side request forgery vulnerability, you could then launch into this whole attack and take over a Kubernetes cluster from an SSRF vulnerability. Here's one of the other core concepts that you need to understand for this chain of vulnerability. When this admissions controller code actually executes, it generates a temporary Nginx configuration file, and then it runs an Nginx-T command on that code. So the researchers found a way to inject new configuration directives into this code path that then, when the admissions controller goes to test it, it will actually run the code. So right here it says, typically only the Kubernetes API server should be sending these admission review requests. However, because the admission controller lacks authentication, an attacker with minimal network access, so inside that pod, could craft and send an arbitrary admissions review request from any pod within the cluster. Sorry, not within the pod, within the cluster. So then they show an actual YAML file of one of these admission reviews, and they point out that there's a lot of different areas in here that the attacker actually can control. The one that jumped out to me right away when I was looking at it was the path in the URL. And I think that's actually what they wind up using in their POC. But basically, any of the values here that a user can be the one to tamper with needs to be validated, some sort of input validation. And that is completely missing, and that's what led to this vulnerability. So here we go, we get to the first of the CVEs that's used in this attack chain. So as I called out, the URL is something that is provided by the user. So anything in the after the slash is just part of the path, and like you can type whatever you want in that. And they're saying this auth URL annotation, it's incorporated without proper sanitization. So it allows an attacker to inject arbitrary Nginx configuration directives, which do get evaluated when that Nginx -T test actually runs. So here you go, an auth URL, example.com/, and then they'll do a --/, and then this is their engine injection point. So you AppSec nerds will totally understand this is very much like a SQL injection. You're ending the current code with this pound and then a semicolon, and then you are injecting code to this point. And so then the configuration file, once it is then interpreted, we'll say, okay, set this target to example.com, wait, --, and then all of a sudden the attacker is writing code here at the injection point. So the second CVE is also just another injection attack. You can see here, it's just doing it in this auth TLS match CN request instead of just the URL. And you can see their global injection point here as part of their attack. And once again, they break out of the code and their injection lines up into the configuration file. The third CVE found is also another injection point, this time in a UID parameter. And then the fourth, this is the big one. This is the one that's actually rated 9.8. And this is the actual code execution point. So as they say, any one of the three CVEs that we just went through could be used to inject arbitrary directives into the Nginx configuration, which will then be run by this Nginx-T test. But that does not automatically lead to code execution. And they said, hey, if we can find a directive that does execute arbitrary code in the Nginx-T, it'll compromise the pod and it's highly privileged. So there's a ton of directives, and the one that they pulled out, they said they tried this load module directive, but it didn't work. And the one that they did end up on is this SSL engine directive, which is part of the OpenSSL module. It has an undocumented feature to load shared libraries. And critically, it can be used at any point within the configuration file, so it doesn't have an order of its operations. So one of the other clever things that they realized in this attack is that Nginx actually saves the request body into a temporary file in /tmp. But it only does this when the HTTP request body is of a certain size. By default, that setting is about 8 kilobytes. So if they send a really big HTTP request containing their payload, Nginx will temporarily save that to a file in the pod's file system. But also by default, Nginx just erases all of that stuff pretty much immediately. But Nginx holds an open file descriptor pointing to that file, which is accessible from the procfs. But they actually need to keep that open. So the other trick is they set the content length header to be huge so that Nginx is actually waiting for more data to meet that content length header number. But that data isn't coming, the attack is actually happening. So they have to go through and actually guess the PID and the FD number to find out where that shared library is in that temporary file. But you're in a container, you're not in like a full VM, so this should be pretty minimal. So they upload a payload in the form of a shared library, abusing that whole client body buffer thing that we just went through in the temporary files. Then, since it's unauthenticated, they sent an admission review request to the Ingress Nginx controller, which can use any one of those injection breakouts that we showed. They inject into the SSL engine directive, as we said, can load their code from any point in that configuration file, which they could use to then load the specified file as a shared library, the specified file meaning the one that they've uploaded to this temporary file structure. Then they have to specify the procfs path to the file descriptor of our payload. They have to guess this, it'll be clear in the demo. And then when it all works, our shared library is now loaded and they can execute code remotely. So here's the demo, I'll pause it at a few points because it goes pretty fast. They open a listening port here, I'm gonna pause it real quick. So here's the actual exploit in action at the top. So this is a Python, running an exploit.py. They're running it into the Ingress Nginx controller on port 80 and port 443. And then I'm going to hit play. And then here you go. This is them actually guessing that proc and that FD number, because they don't know it's in that temporary file system. And then boom, you see it happen on the bottom. They have a connection received. So one of the numbers that they guessed above here worked. So here you are in Nginx. They're gonna show just the bottom now because the thing worked, and they're gonna show the privileges that they have. They go into temp, they're grabbing kubectl or kubectl, however you say it. And they're showing that they can get the secrets from the whole cluster. And like I said at the beginning of the video, this is just scratching the surface. As I said, they were kind of surprised at the lack of least privileged design. So even though this vulnerability existed, they didn't need to end up with the full privileges of the cluster at the end of that. They said during this research, they found other vulnerabilities in Ingress Nginx controller. While yes, that controller is wildly popular on over 40% of kube installs, there's a ton of other admission controllers. The timeline on this one also made me laugh a little bit. New Year's Eve is when you dropped this to the Kubernetes team. I feel really bad for whoever was on call and got that 9.8 CVE disclosure on New Year's Eve. They reported one of the other injection vulnerabilities on January 2nd, and then Kubernetes acknowledged the reports on January 3rd. So they got back to the office, apparently. Then they bounced back and forth on the fix for weeks. So this shows a lot of collaboration between the Wiz research team and the Kubernetes security team. And then here you see this week, public disclosure. This was going on all year here. It's taken them a while to get the fix out, but it wasn't public knowledge until this point. And then a lot of places keep mentioning 5 vulnerabilities. I see only 4 CVEs in the research above. So I don't know if there's some other vulnerabilities that we just don't know about yet. But okay, what is Kubernetes saying? I want to hop over to, this is their official blog about the whole incident. They reiterate how popular this Ingress controller is. They say 40% of Kubernetes clusters have it deployed. The vulnerabilities are all patched. They call out right away that this 9.8 CVE says that this means that anything on the pod network has a good chance of taking over your whole Kubernetes cluster with no credentials or administrative access required. So they're saying in common scenarios, the pod network is accessible to all workloads in your cloud VPC or even anyone connected to your corporate network. This is a very serious situation. This is straight from the Kubernetes own blog on this. So here you go. You have a kubectl command to figure out if you are impacted, just looking for this Ingress Nginx controller. Then they have upgrade and patch instructions with or without Helm. If you're not using Helm, you definitely should be using Helm. Basically just saying you got to get onto the right version to patch all five of today's vulnerabilities. Again, I don't know where this fifth one is, unless I'm miscounting. They also mentioned if for whatever reason you can't upgrade right away, you can greatly reduce your risk by turning off that whole validating admission controllers feature. So here's the actual config line item if you want to turn that off. All right, this is a wild one. This is a bad day to be a kube admin. This is not even that easy of an upgrade. Yeah, it's like an easy switch to flip, but I know of some massive Kubernetes deployments out there. Even with a Helm chart, you've got to be worried about upgrading something in the critical path of your web traffic like this. I'm just glad that even though Wiz notified Kube of this on New Year's Eve, we got notification of this on a Monday. So everyone's had a few of actual work days worth of patching. Hopefully not a whole lot of overtime hours on this. All right, do you like these kind of breakdowns of these vulnerabilities? Kubernetes vulnerabilities are notoriously hard to explain. I know a lot of you watching may have no idea about what I'm talking about. Hopefully I kept it at least somewhat interesting enough. I like doing these vulnerability explanations, but let me know if you like these. I'll keep them up. Please do all the YouTube things below. It really helps me as I get this channel going, and it tells me that you want me to keep doing stuff like this. You can also find the link to my free weekly newsletter down below. I already talked about this in there earlier this week, so if you were subscribed, you would have already learned about this. Anyway, thanks so much for watching. Follow for more cybersecurity news.